If my parents were alive today, and they both died young, it would have been incomprehensible for them. Incomprehensible. The idea that their son, coming from where we came from, to become a United States senator or a mayor of Burlington or a candidate for president of the United States, it would have been unthinkable. Unthinkable.
CNN held a town hall with Bernie Sanders, and I'm going to show you a few highlights here from his responses. Now, from all I've heard from people that watched the entire town hall, I didn't have the time to see the entire town hall, but from what I understand, people of New Hampshire were actually very impressed by his appearance here, and he appeared a little more personable than maybe Sanders sometimes does. So let me show you some of his responses.
Hi, hello. Thank you for being here. How do you think your Jewish heritage impacts your vision of the world and politics? And do you think it is a help or a hindrance to your role as a candidate?
It impacts me very profoundly. You know, when I try to think about how I came to the views that I hold, there are two major factors, I think. Although one never knows, but I think there are two factors. Number one, I grew up in a family, didn't have a whole lot of money, and we struggled economically, and that made me aware that there are tens of millions of people who are in that same boat. And the second one is being Jewish. And I remember as a kid looking at these big picture books of World War II, and tears would roll down my cheeks when I saw what happened to the Jewish people. 6 million people were killed by Hitler. And, you know, I think at a very early age, even before my political thoughts were developed, I was aware of the horrible things that human beings can do to other people in the name of racism or white nationalism, or in this case, Nazism. And in the community that I lived in, there were people, you go downtown and you shop, people had their tattoos from the concentration camps on their arm. A few years ago, my wife and I and my brother and his wife went back to the town in Poland where my father was born. And we were shown, people there were very, very nice, and we were shown an area where the Nazis had put in some 300 people and just mowed them down in a ditch. So that had, how horrible people can be to other people in the names of racial superiority or et cetera, certainly has been with me for my entire life. And that is why I will do everything I can to end the kind of divisiveness that Trump is fomenting in this country. We are one people, and I don't care if you're black, you're white, you're Latino, Native American, Asian American, you're gay, you're straight. That's not what it's about. What it's about is that we are human beings and we share common dreams and aspirations. So, the pain that my family, my father's family suffered in Poland is something that has impacted my life, absolutely.
So I think this is important for Bernie to discuss his Jewish heritage, because a lot of people need to feel like they connect with the candidate they support. Now, obviously, above and all, what matters above everything else is what the person has fought for, what the candidate has fought for their entire life, the policies, the platform, who they hire, what they discuss, all that matters. But also, being able to connect with people on a personal level, I think, also matters too, because, again, some people need to be able to feel that connection to show that you were actually sincere in what you were fighting for. Even though I think it's obvious, I mean, you go back, you see videos of Bernie in the 80s and 90s fighting for the exact same thing, and fighting for those issues as a leader at the time, like getting into an argument with somebody in the House over them being homophobic. This is back in the 90s. Bernie is calling somebody else out for being homophobic. I mean, this is when this is at a time when it was not acceptable to be accepting of the gay community, and Bernie Sanders back then was fighting for them. So when you see, moments like that back in time, I think that shows you that he's a real human being. He actually cares. He actually cares about this fight. But also, many people haven't seen those clips, even though they should, but many people haven't seen those clips. So to be able to have moments like this on stage where you're discussing your heritage, discussing who you are, what's impacted you, I think that allows voters to connect with you on a deeper level. Let me show you this next clip here. This is about healthcare.
Hello, Senator Sanders. I'm drawn to your plan for universal healthcare, but I'm skeptical since I've been hearing about universal healthcare from every political candidate I've voted for. What makes your plan different and able to become a reality?
Thank you very much, Alicia. And you're right. You have been hearing about that. And you've been hearing about it, or Americans have been hearing about it, for a lot longer than you've been alive. Teddy Roosevelt, way back when, over 100 years ago, talked about universal health care. FDR talked about it in the 30s and 40s. Truman talked about it. Johnson did something about it, talked about it. Obama talked about it. Jimmy Carter, Richard Nixon even talked about it. All right. But what has been the problem all of this time? The problem is, at the end of the day, if we want universal health care, if we want to do what every other major country on earth does, this is not a radical idea. I live in Burlington, Vermont, 50 miles away from the Canadian border. They do it. Everybody has health care. You don't take out your wallet or your credit card when you go to the doctor or the hospital. They spend one half as much per capita as we spend. So, Alicia, the question is, why hasn't it happened? And the answer is, we have not had the courage as a people to take on the greed and the corruption of the healthcare industry, the insurance companies and the drug companies. Why do you think we are paying, in some cases, 10 times more for the same exact medicine sold in Canada or in Europe? 10 times more. And it has everything to do with the fact that the pharmaceutical industry, over the last several decades, has spent billions of dollars on lobbying and campaign contributions. They buy Congress. Alicia, the drug companies and the insurance companies will not buy me. I don't take their money. I don't need their money. We are going to take them on. In America, we will not pay the highest prices in the world for prescription drugs, and we will, in fact, move to a Medicare for all, single-payer system, quality, comprehensive care for all, and it will cost the average American substantially less than that family is paying today.
So that was a great response. And I actually like this question as well, because, you know, oftentimes the question is so stupid. It's like, how can you pay for Medicare for all? When Medicare for all, every piece of information, every country shows you a single payer system would cost less than the current private system, for the obvious reason, because you take out the profit-making middleman. So the question should never be framed about how can you afford Medicare for all when it's less expensive than the current system. The question should be, we've been talking about universal health care forever. Why don't we have it yet? And why should I believe you that you'll get it done? I think that's a fair question. And Bernie has the right answer. He's not taking their money. He's the first one to completely cut them off. So he's not controlled by them. And he has a 40-year career of fighting for universal health care. So you add that together, you know that he's being sincere and he will actually fight for it. And as I've discussed a million times, as a Canadian who lives under a single-payer system, I never think about health care. If I need it, I get it. I have a health card. I walk in. They look at my health card, and then I go see my doctor. Then I walk out and leave. Like, there's no money exchange. There's no insurance. There's no calling insurance companies. Nothing's going on. I just walk into a clinic and I leave. I had surgery once. It's the same kind of deal. Ahead of time, you plan the surgery. There's maybe like one sheet of paperwork, just to get, you know, personal details. And then I go on the day I get my surgery. I walk in. They know who I am. I have my health card. Get the surgery. Wake up. Go home. That's it. Like, there's nothing else. It is simple. It is straightforward. You have complete freedom. You're no longer tied to an employer. You can start your own business. You can go back to school, and you're going to have health care because it's guaranteed to you through the single-payer system. You can go to any doctor, any walk-in clinic, because there is no in-network, out-of-network. Everybody's in the same network. So it completely removes all that barrier. It's actual freedom when it comes to health care. I mean, the debate is over. It's obvious a single-payer system, a Medicare for all single-payer system, is where you need to move to. It's just a matter of getting there. And to get there, you need a political leader that is rejecting all of their money, rejects them completely, and supports the people, and is supported by the people. So, and has a record of actually fighting for universal health care. And you have that in Bernie Sanders. Let's go to the last clip here. This is, I actually really enjoyed this. Again, Bernie gets a little more personal here.
What do you think the young Bernie Sanders in Brooklyn in the 1940s would say if he could see where you are now?
You know, I think about that, Anderson, and I think about my parents. The idea, you know, there are some people who get in politics whose families have a whole lot of money. Maybe their dads were a governor or a senator, you know. And it becomes normal for them. That's the expectation. You know, they say to the 8-year-old kid, someday you're going to be a governor. You're going to be a United States senator. If my parents were alive today, and they both died young, it would have been incomprehensible for them. Incomprehensible. The idea that their son, coming from where we came from, to become a United States senator or a mayor of Burlington or a candidate for president of the United States, it would have been unthinkable. Unthinkable.
So I just thought that was a nice moment. It really is incredible. Like, seeing where Bernie came from, his mom dying very young when he was a kid, his father also dying young, and essentially him and his brother growing up, making it, and Bernie getting involved in, you know, the civil rights movement early on and getting involved in politics early on, and just the way he's grown as a person, like, from you know, losing race after race after race to eventually winning, to eventually becoming, you know, mayor of Burlington, Vermont, to then becoming a member of the House, to then becoming a senator, to then becoming someone running for president. I mean, it's an incredible journey. And the entire time, he has not compromised who he is. How many people in politics can you say that about? He has stood strong with the people the entire time. He is a fighter, and he wasn't getting the recognition for it. It's not like he was doing it for headlines. No one knew who the hell Bernie Sanders was until very late in his life. Most people did know who he was till he ran for president in 2016. So this shows you somebody who is just completely selfless, has always put himself on the line for other people, has always fought for humanity as a whole. He is a once-in-a-lifetime candidate. And I think it's obvious. And you have the opportunity here to actually have this man who actually cares about people as your president. Understand the moment you're in.